Excellent. I was beginning to think maybe first service needed more caffeine. They just need to learn the value of sleeping in. You guys have some energy in here. Awesome. Awesome. Glad to be here. Well, David is away. He's enjoying some much-needed time with family and extended family on vacation for Father's Day. Not a lot of senior pastors would pull a stunt like that and leave you on Father's Day. I'm saying it's an important day. But I think he thought if he found another guy with a soul patch and gave him, like, let him continue the sermon series, you wouldn't even notice. So we're slightly different in height, so maybe you picked up on it. Well, we're talking today. We're going to be in Luke 23. And we are talking about Jesus being made a spectacle for us so we didn't have to be. And so we're continuing the series that we've been doing with keeping calm and carrying on and just really getting into the Word of God. And it's really cool you guys are going through the entire book of Luke. You know, if you're here and you happen to be one of the normal Easter and Christmas crowd people, you know, that this may be a daunting task and it's a commitment to be here for weeks and weeks and weeks on end, but he couldn't do it in his defense on Christmas and Easter because, you know, that would take years. You know, well, now we're in Luke 2. We did Luke 1 at Easter, and now we're at Christmas, and this is the only time we're going to hit the Christmas story. I don't know. It would just take a long time. We don't have to be made a spectacle of, and what that basically means is that when we come before God one day, if you know Jesus Christ and you've had his forgiveness of your sins, he doesn't pull you up in front of everybody and say, ah, no, not you. There's something there that's keeping, there's a sin in place, there's a barrier between us and you're going to have to depart from me. Jesus has already been lifted up. He's already become that spectacle on our behalf. When I think about being a spectacle, I think back about 12 years. I just moved to Mooresville. And I was a youth pastor at a church in Mooresville and excited about it. And I didn't know these kids yet. They didn't really know me. They'd only heard me a couple times. And I'm still trying to, you know, impress them because I was 25. And at 25, I thought the best way to teach them about Jesus is for them to think I'm cool. If I'm cool, then they'll definitely want to meet my friend Jesus. I was totally wrong. And looking back now as 30, almost 37, I'd probably do a different approach now. But we went to this thing called Sunfest. Anybody ever been to Sunfest at Carowinds? Yeah, it's that good. Three of you went. So it draws everybody in. I know. It's on your bucket list. I realize it. So we got to Carowinds, and I had grown up listening to a lot of really hard rock and punk rock and all this. So we went to all these local shows where people were crowd surfing by. People were crowd surfing people who didn't want to crowd surf by. You know, they're in a fold. I'm not kidding. There was a folding chair going by one time. And it was like, that's what he gets for being a fuddy-duddy in the back. You know, and we just had fun. We would jump off the stage And we're at this Christian concert, and this new generation of kids don't understand that. And they're just like, it's like Toby Mac or whoever playing there. And I'm like, we don't have to stay in these rows. I mean, there's a few people down the front. You guys want to go front with me? No. I'm like, you don't like it? No, we love it. Yeah, these guys have been weaned on a lemon. What is happening here? We need to get down there. We need to do something. And so it started hitting me. You know, maybe if I go down there first, and I'm jumping around, I'm being crazy, and I'm doing this, they'll want to come to me. That's how stupid I was to think that, hey, look, a 25-year-old, he's awesome, you know. Maybe I could get on the front of the stage and jump off, and they'd see me. So I start making my way down there. I excuse myself from my row. I'm making our way down there. And I get down there, and there's two security guards, one on each side, right in front of the big speaker stacks, and they're just kind of standing here like all ominous-like. And I realize they're just preventing people from moshing. These guys aren't guarding the stairs at all. There's a speaker stack behind this guy, then there's a staircase that kind of goes backstage. So I just mosey my way up the staircase. I come out beside the drummer for Audio Adrenaline. And Audio Adrenaline, the guy, the drummer looks at me like, there's this look in his eyes like, why do we even have security? I don't know how many times this has happened to him, but I just kind of look at him like, no, it's cool, I got this. And I start running across the stage, and the guitarist moves out of my way. He's, like, moving over, and I'm trying to avoid him. I mean, that would be terrible if I just knocked them out of tune. How's it going? I'm Nate. You know, I run past the lead singer and hit to the front of the stage. I'm just going to dive. Just go as far as I can go. I kind of look at my students like, yeah. Miracles still happen, folks. I didn't have to lift a staff or anything. It just parted. And about where we're out, I don't know if you've been in the amphitheater they have at Carowinds, but they got this space down front where everybody was standing. They just really moved. But then there's three rows of seats, and I'm a tall guy, and at the time, at 25, I could jump. I don't think I can anymore. I've had some ankle issues. But I just leapt off there like I was trying to dunk from the half court or something, or foul line's what I was looking for. That would be awesome, half court. I want to see somebody do that. You know, Michael Jordan style. Three rows of chairs I landed on. I had a bruise right here, just a line of a bruise right here. One right here, that was close. I was glad it was that high. One right down here, and I just kind of make my way back to the students. I had been laying there, and people looking down at me, and I'm looking up at them like, what's wrong with your generation? Generation I'm called to reach is lamer than mine was. You know, I go back to the students, and they think it's hilarious. The leaders who are there think, what a moron. And I just made a spectacle of myself. But Jesus came to make himself a spectacle for us, not to be stupid or to try to get our attention in that way, but because he loved us. Because he wanted to show us how much he cared about us, that he would die in our place, that he would take our penalty in place of his. So if you've got your Bibles, we're right in Luke 23. It's going to be on the screen as well. But we are going to get right into it. We're going to start in verse 6. Now, the first five verses, it's not like they're not important, but Jesus had come before Pilate, and Pilate had determined that he's basically going to send him off to Herod. So that's what's happening in the very, very first part of this chapter. It says in verse 6, on hearing this, Pilate asked if the man was a Galilean. Now, this has happened multiple times where they would hear somebody talk. Remember Peter before the fire when he betrayed Jesus? And they're like, hey, your speech betrays you. You're a Galilean. I don't know how Galileans spoke back then, if they had like a southern drawl or something like that. You know, but when Galileans spoke, people were like, yeah, you're from Galilee, dude. Okay. And so Jesus had been talking, and they're like, you know what? He's a Galilean. And this political ploy comes to the forefront of Pilate's mind of, oh, I can get back in the good graces of Herod. Now, he doesn't have to be in the good graces of Herod. Herod is running the show as far as like a puppet. He's got a little bit more power. I mean, he can still kill people and stuff like that, but it's like Queen Elizabeth on steroids. You know, like he's a puppet, and he has power, but not more power than Rome. So Pilate's the man. He can do whatever he wants, and Herod's got this jurisdiction over Judea and places like that, but for some reason, these guys had not been talking. We're going to find out in the text as we go. Had not been talking, and he thinks, hey, I can give a show of solidarity here that I actually care for and value Herod's leadership. I'll let him judge Jesus. I'll send him to Herod. It says in verse 7, when he learned that Jesus was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him to Herod, who was also in Jerusalem at the time. Now, this is the same Herod that killed Jesus' cousin, John the Baptist. Not the one who tried to kill Jesus when he was a baby and they went off to Egypt. This is his son. And he killed John the Baptist. If you remember this story, Jesus heard about it. He wanted to get alone with his father. People wouldn't leave him alone, so he gave him a bunch of fish and bread. I mean, for everybody, 5,000 people. He still tried to get alone with his father. The storm popped up, and then getting alone with his father, he walked across on the water. I mean, some cool stuff going down, but Jesus remembers the pain of that moment. He knows that John the Baptist was a great guy. Jesus said of John the Baptist, there was no one born among women who was greater than John the Baptist, which is a huge statement since Jesus was born of woman. So obviously it tells us what he thinks of John the Baptist, the forerunner of the gospel, this great man, this great prophet. And now for the first time ever, they are right in front of each other, Herod and Jesus. The killer of the forerunner of the gospel, the killer of this prophet, the killer of Jesus' own earthly cousin, right here, and he's standing before, and that's got to be, that would be in my mind, I'd be like, oh, I just want to tell you one thing, smite. Where did Herod go? He's the pile of ashes, that's where he went, killed my cousin, it's been a long time coming. Yeah, you know, that's how I imagine, that's why I'm not God, by the way, I don't know, if you haven't figured it out by now. Be glad we have the God that we have, because I wouldn't make the same decisions. His ways are so much higher than my ways. And stands before Herod, verse 8, when Herod saw Jesus, he was greatly pleased, because for a long time he wanted to see him. From what he had heard about him, he hoped to see some sort of a sign of some sort. Now, in Luke 13, three chapters ago, the Pharisees had told Jesus, if Herod ever gets a hold of you, he's going to kill you. It wasn't true. They just heard Herod wanted Jesus. But he wanted Jesus because he wanted Jesus to perform. It was like seeing somebody in the subway play a saxophone, or he wanted a juggler. Like, Jesus, do something. Swallow fire. Like, I mean, he was just excited. This is Jesus? All right, let's see what he's got. He wanted to see Jesus. Now, this entire time, Jesus' ministry has been going throughout Judea, and Herod's just been hearing things. Just been hearing. What did he do yesterday? Healed a blind guy who was blind from birth? What he healed? A guy who was crippled after his friends broke somebody's roof and they didn't have homeowner's insurance? Wow. You know what I mean? Like, he was hearing all of this kind of stuff, all these things Jesus did. It would get back to Herod, and he's like, I want to see it. I want to see something cool. I want to see something awesome. Go get the toaster that's broken. See what Jesus can do with that. I mean, he really wanted to see some really cool stuff happen, and Jesus doesn't do it. And it says he plied him, this is verse 9, he plied him with many questions, but Jesus gave him no answer. The chief priests and teachers of the law were standing there vehemently accusing him. Then Herod and his soldiers ridiculed and mocked him, dressing him in an elegant robe. They sent him back to Pilate. This starts escalating. He's asking Jesus, okay, Jesus, did you do what they said you're doing? Are you claiming to be the God of the Jews, the King of the Jews, the God of the Hebrews? Is that you? Jesus didn't say anything. So the Pharisees are like, oh, no, he's going to get off the hook. No, no, he said this. He did this. He did that. He did this. He did that. Say it, Jesus. Say it. Tell him. You know, and they're just yelling at him. And then after that, they keep chiding him and saying how much he's the King of the Jews, wannabe, and all this stuff. He's not really the Messiah. He hasn't done what we thought the Messiah should do, and all this stuff. And then the Herod soldiers start getting into it. They're like, yeah, who do you think you are? You think you're the King of the Jews? Woo, King of the Jews. We usually follow Herod. Maybe we'll follow you now. They put a robe on him. Now, in the other Gospels, they talk about this robe, the robe that Pilate puts on him later. It's like a purple robe that symbolizes the kingship in Roman culture. But in Jewish culture, the kingly robes were white. They were like shimmering white. And so this first robe that they put on him, it's the first of two robes they'll put on him, was this type of white robe that they would do to hey, look, you look just like Herod now. Should we follow you? Jesus doesn't say anything. He just sits through it. He doesn't do what Herod wanted him to do, so Herod decides, let's send him back. So that day, Herod and Pilate became friends. Before this, they had been enemies, verse 12. That's very interesting. This political move by Pilate was so that he could say, look, I respect your leadership. You're a crazy guy. You've killed some of your own children, and you lop off people's heads. You're kind of like a early ISIS, but hey, I respect you. He's like, okay, great. I mean, Herod was kind of a crazy guy, and Pilate did this to get back in his good graces so that everything goes smoothly in the land. He never wants anybody to hear of an insurrection in his area because then he would be removed from office or killed. And so he wanted to continue that, so he gets back in good with Herod, all because of Jesus. Verse 13, Pilate called together the chief priests and rulers of the people. This is after he sends him back. And said to them, you brought me this man as one who was inciting the people to rebellion. I've examined him in your presence. I found no basis for your charges against him. Neither has Herod, for he sent him back to us. And as you can see, he's done nothing that deserves death. Therefore, I will punish him and then will release him. Now, that's weird to me. I mean, think about this. You're standing in courtroom, and you're all worried, and the jury comes back, and they give their little verdict, and they're like, not guilty. And you're like, oh, I'm so relieved. And the judge stands up and says, okay, not guilty. Therefore, we're going to beat the snot out of him and let him go. I'm just standing there at the thing with my lawyer like, what? You know, like, no, that's not the way it works. But this is, Pilate was trying to please everybody and have his hand in every little pot. He said, okay, I don't find anything wrong with him. Nothing deserving of death, so are we cool? I'll beat him and then let him go? Is that good enough? I mean, Jesus didn't speak up at that moment either. Like, well, excuse me, I heard not guilty. What's the beating for? He knew he had to fulfill prophecy, that we'd be healed by his stripes, and Jesus goes along with it. He doesn't say anything, and they let this happen. They let this sentence take place. He's going to be beat with fragments of bone and fragments of glass within these whips that the Roman soldiers use. It's going to be terrible. They're going to place this robe on his back and it's going to stick to him and then they're going to rip it off. And all this stuff's going to happen to him after he's been found innocent. And Pilate just hoping that he'll appease the priests. Look, guys, don't create any problems. You think he's an insurrectionist, which is basically them just trying to get Jesus in trouble. Hey, he's going to overthrow Rome. Aren't you at least concerned about that? I'll deal with this. I'll beat him, but then we'll let him go. Verse 17, if you look in your Bible, how many of you in your Bible, if you've got a Bible with you or a YouVersion or whatever you happen to be looking at, you don't have verse 17? Raise your hand if verse 17 is not there. It's just like an asterisk. Okay, so I'm a skeptic. I've always been a skeptic. I was a skeptic before I became to Christ. I was an agnostic. So when I saw stuff like this, I was like, see, not true. In case you're wondering, if you get worried when you're reading through there, like a verse 16, and you don't really notice normally, you just kind of flow and read. But when you're doing a verse-by-verse study for weeks on end, and we like go, 16? Okay, if you look in verse 18, wait, sir, you skipped one. Where's verse 17 at? Okay, verse 17 is not in the oldest manuscripts that we have. So where this possibly came from, it's a direct quote from Matthew and from Mark, because they share this. Luke didn't include it. He already had Matthew, Mark of the day. He knew all the Christians could read those. He didn't need to add information that they already had. But the scholars later on, not wanting somebody to read through Luke and not get all of the truth that Matthew and Mark had put, just put in this direct quote from Matthew and from Mark. And so it's still inspired. It's inspired when it was in Matthew and Mark. It's inspired when they put it in Luke. It wasn't originally written in Luke, but it's still inspired. You see what I'm saying? It doesn't change the meaning of the gospel or anything. But later, recently, scholars have said, yeah, Luke didn't put it. We've already got Matthew and Mark. They're all in the same issue. People can read all of it. Let's go ahead and pull it back out since it's not in the original. And it hasn't changed anything. It didn't add anything or take anything away from God's message. And it was inspired. Even what they added was inspired because it was a different part of Scripture. So there's no qualms, but I want you to know what it says anyway, just so we can kind of keep this in perspective, since we're only looking at Luke's gospel, and since you might be totally lost when you see an asterisk in your Bible and not listen the rest of the time, we're going to fill it in. So Matthew 27:15, now it was the governor's custom at the festival to release a prisoner chosen by the crowd. And if you look in old Jewish customs in the Talmud, which is like a companion to the Bible with a bunch of extra rules, they had this Talmud that they would go, this isn't in there. We can't find anything in ancient Hebrew lore of this being their custom. So the custom was actually from the Romans. The Romans would do this. It's probably borrowed from a Greek custom that was called thesmoria, where they would release prisoners. But this is kind of a thing that they would give this basically give a prisoner to the Jews to kind of placate them. So they think, oh, they're being nice to us. They let somebody go. See, the Jews didn't have a concept of this. You see in the New Testament, you see Paul and Silas in prison. You see Jesus in prison during the night of his trials that he's drugged back and forth. You see Peter in prison. John, he's exiled to Patmos. It's like an Alcatraz-type island. He's in prison. But in the Old Testament, you don't find prison among the Hebrews. See, they had different things that they would do, and so this wasn't a normal thing. Rome comes along, they take over, and now they're taking hundreds of us and putting us in jail for different things. They didn't do that. You just made up for it right then. So if you couldn't afford to pay a debt where you had dug a hole and you didn't properly put stuff around your hole and somebody's mule fell in there and broke its neck, you owed them a mule. You couldn't pay the mule. Okay, you're going to work for them for a while. You're going to work off the debt. They just took care of things right then. If it was something really minor that you sinned and did, you should go to the temple and light some incense. Some incense. I mean, there's some sins I might would do just to light some cinnamon in. Which is cinnamon? Which one's the cinnamon? Okay, awesome. Lord, you know I'm sorry, but I'll be back next week too, you know. But for more serious sins, it might be turtle doves. If you've ever played Mario, you know turtle doves are the turtles with the white wings. That's not true. If you haven't played Mario, you don't know what I'm talking about. But I always called them turtle doves as a kid, but even though they were Koopas or something, Koopas. It doesn't matter. My mind works in weird ways. You might have to bring a sheep. You might have to bring an actual cow, depending on the seriousness, or the seriousness of your sin could cost you your very life. But it wasn't going to put you in prison for the rest of your life. They didn't have a concept of that, and so they didn't waste tax money on it and everything else, and this big complex. We won't talk about what we do here. But I'm just saying, sometimes you just got to kill somebody. I'm just joking. So they took care of it. But the Romans, they put a bunch of people in prison. They would put some of them to death, and they had all these people in prison, and once a year they would placate the people by saying, hey, well, we'll give you one. And we took 100 of you. Here's one back. And so they would let the people have somebody, and this kind of was an opportunity for Pilate to rub all sides. Okay, I pleased Herod by letting him have jurisdiction. I pleased these Pharisees by, I'm going to beat Jesus. I've said I'm going to beat him. Now I can even please the people and say, look, now we're going to show mercy. I showed the strength of Rome, and now mercy. Man, this is going to be an awesome day for me as a leader. It's awesome. And so it doesn't go the way he thought. And he's going to have Jesus beaten, and he's using this custom that was found in Matthew. And we jump back in at verse 18 of Luke 23, it says, "But the whole crowd shouted, 'Away with this man, release Barabbas to us.'" Then we got the parentheses there. Barabbas had been thrown into prison for an insurrection in the city and for murder. Okay, so he's got Jesus standing there, and they're like, "Nope! Barabbas, the insurrectionist, the murderer. Bring him to us." And you might think, "Whoa, whoa, whoa, that's not it. That's not even a hands down. That's a hands down easy decision to make," but not in their context it wasn't. See, in their context, an insurrectionist did not like Rome. They were zealots. They lied in wait for the caravan of troops for their pay to come in, their tribute to come in and stuff, and they would lie in wait and they would take it and they would kill Romans or they would have an uproar, they would incite the people, and this guy had been taken for that very thing, the very thing that they wanted Jesus to do. Everybody kept saying, "At this time, are you going to restore the kingdom to Israel? Jesus, are you going to do something about this? When are you going to overthrow Rome, Jesus?" Even his disciples asking him these questions. And Jesus didn't comply with that. He was here for a completely different reason. He wasn't here to save us from Rome. He was here to save us from our sins. The real problem, the root of all of it, the thing that's separating us from the God that created us. But Barabbas was doing everything the Messiah should do in the minds of the people. And they were more than willing to receive him instead of Jesus. So they asked for Barabbas, the man who had done all this insurrection and murder. Now in Matthew 27, I want to kind of jump over here for just a second and look at a little bit more information we have about Barabbas that's very, very interesting. Matthew 27, 16 through 17. "At that time, they had a well-known prisoner named Jesus Barabbas." Now, how many of you look at your Bible right there? How many of you? Oh, you're not in Matthew. Sorry. But anyways, I'll just tell you, NIV and several others have his first name there, Jesus Barabbas. Right, which is very, very interesting, because if you have a King James or New King James and you're looking in there, you're like, "I don't see Jesus Barabbas." Where did that come from? Why is it there? In our oldest manuscripts, it has the first name of Barabbas. It has Jesus listed beside it. And more than likely, somewhere along the way, a scholar said, "This is confusing. We should only lift up the name of Jesus, who is the Christ, and not this Jesus Barabbas. It'll be good enough in the story for us just to hear Barabbas." And the story still makes sense. He's still an insurrectionist. He's still a murderer. He's still the wrong Messiah that they're choosing. But putting his first name there kind of gives us something else. See, Jesus was a very common name. When you see something, especially on the History Channel, and they dig up a grave, and there's somebody named Jesus in it, and they're like, "Aha, see, he didn't raise from the dead." Well, dig up that grave from that family, and that grave from that family, and that grave from that family. They probably had a kid named Jesus, too. It was like John Smith. It was an extremely common name for somebody to be Jesus. But what wasn't common about this particular Jesus, this false Jesus, is his last name was Barabbas. It says, "So when the crowd gathered, Pilate asked them, 'Which one do you want me to release to you, Jesus Barabbas or Jesus who's called the Messiah?' For he knew it was out of self-interest they had handed Jesus over to them." He thought, "Maybe I can sway the crowd by pulling them both up together and say, 'Look, this is Jesus Barabbas. Here is Jesus who is called the Christ.'" Like, I mean, this is a guy who even has, like, a good reputation about him. But what he was offering the people at that moment was Jesus Barabbas. Barabbas, Bar Abbas means son of. Bar always means son of the Father. So do you want Jesus who is son of the Father or Jesus who is called son of the Father, the Messiah, the Savior? He's offering them this choice, and when they look at these two Jesuses, they pick the wrong one because he's doing the things they thought the Messiah was coming to do and not the things the Messiah intended to do. We do that too. If you're getting mugged, somebody's got you down, they're beating you up, and you think you're fearing for your life, you wouldn't care if you got a text at that moment saying that somebody wanted to pay off your debt. Because your debt is not important to you at the moment. It's always the circumstances we're in at the moment that we want saved from. Always. We don't want saved from the debt. We want saved from the mugging. I want saved from my grandma having cancer or this happening or your marriage falling apart or that unemployment that you're in. And we lose scope that Jesus is about the bigger picture, that sin is the root cause of all of these things happening in the first place. The reason there's cancer in the world and there's death and disease is because the world has fallen. The reason why there's muggings and people don't love their neighbor as themselves is because the world has fallen. But the thing that holds us back from finding God is this barrier, this wall of sin, and Jesus came to take a sledgehammer to it. That's what he asks us to follow him into grace, into forgiveness of sin. But the people at the time couldn't see that over their circumstances, and they chose Jesus, Son of the Father, lowercase. Verse 20, wanting to release Jesus, Pilate appealed to them again. But they kept shouting, "Crucify him, crucify him." For the third time he spoke to them. "Why? What crime has this man committed? I found in him no grounds for the death penalty. Therefore, I will have him punished and release you." Remember, I'm going to beat him. You don't like him, I get it. But should he die? We're going to beat him, and we're going to let him go. And with loud shouts, they insistently demanded that he be crucified. And their shouts prevailed. At some point, Pilate realized, look, this day is not going like I thought it was when I was trying to appease everybody. This could become a riot. This could be the reason I die or I'm removed from office. And so he gives in to them. He lets it go. So he decided to grant their demand. He released the man who had been thrown in prison for insurrection and murder, the one they had asked for. Jesus to their will. Verse 26, as the soldiers led him away, they seized Simon of Cyrene, who was on his way in from the country, and put the cross on him and made him carry it behind Jesus. This was a cruel act in and of itself. Think about this. He's there because the city is swelling to capacity for Passover. So he's probably wearing his best. He's planning on making a trip to the temple. According to the old song, Watch the Lamb, his kids are with him. That's not in the Bible, but you know. He's got plans. He's got his finest duds on and everything. And this other guy's been bleeding on rough-hewn wood, and they take it off of him, and they're just like, "You carry this. I don't want to get my clothes dirty. Are you kidding me? I have to carry." The Romans were like that. They would find somebody and say, "Carry my stuff." And the law was they had to carry it for a mile. Remember what Jesus said about that? They do that. When you get to the end of the mile, say, "Oh, I'm good for two." Because it blows their minds with love. What do you mean you're good for two? Because they wouldn't say thank you after the first mile. Thanks for doing it, because you were obligated to do it. It was the second mile that was the gift. And here this man had to carry this cross for Jesus without wanting to do so. Jesus carried his cross for us because he wanted to. And he asks us every day to deny ourselves and take up our cross and follow him. To not worry about what we're wearing, to not worry about our plans, but to put ourselves and our own motivation to the side and to follow Jesus. Verse 27, a large number of people followed him, including women who mourned and wailed for him. Jesus turned and said to them, and Jesus takes time out to prophesy. This is a cool thing. He could be like, "Yeah, I know, it's terrible, but I'm doing it for you." He takes time out to prophesy and to bring things into perspective. He says, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me. Weep for yourselves and for your children. For the time is coming when you will say, 'Blessed are the childless women, the wombs that have never bore, the breasts that have never nursed.' Then they will say, 'Let the mountains fall on us, let the hills cover us.' For if people do these things when the tree is green, what will happen when it is dry?" You know, if we're complaining about how society is now, wait till the tree dries up. Wait till there's no fruit on it. He was prophesying about what would happen in 70 AD. In 70 AD, Rome would have enough of the revolts and the rebellions. And who knows? We're not told this, but maybe Barabbas was the catalyst. Maybe he got back out and was like, "Kill all the Romans!" And then the Romans are like, "Okay, we're done." Because it was just a short time afterwards, less than 40 years, and all of a sudden Rome's like, "We're done. Too many insurrections, too many things." And had they not chosen, I like to think, had they not chosen Barabbas, maybe they wouldn't have got their whole city destroyed. Just saying. Chose the wrong guy. He's like, "Revolt!" Burn them, you know, and so they come in, they burn everything from 70 AD to 1948. No home for the Jews. Just spread all over the world. All because, and Jesus takes time to prophesy about this. He's always about teaching. He's always about preparing people and letting them know. And so he tells them these things. It's got to baffle the women's mind. This guy's beat to a bloody pulp, and he's like, "You don't cry for me, cry for you. Especially those of you with kids. We're trying to hide from Roman soldiers while your baby's crying. You know, it's coming. Something's going to happen, and it's not going to be good." Two other men, both criminals, were also led out with him to be executed. Verse 33, when they came to the place called the Skull or Golgotha, They crucified him there along with the criminals, one on his right, one on his left. And Jesus said, as they're mocking him, as they're doing all this stuff, spitting on him, and they've been doing it since the trials, Jesus says, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And then the soldiers divided up his clothes by casting lots. The people stood around, the rulers with them, and they said, "He saved others. Let him save himself if he's God's Messiah, the chosen one." The soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine vinegar, and they said, "If you're the king of the Jews, save yourself." I think that they weren't even planning it. In one of the other gospels, it says that he refused it, but I don't think they were ever going to give it to him. It was a form of mockery. Like, "Hey, you thirsty? Here's some water." "Never mind." They were offering him this wine vinegar to help him, supposedly, but they weren't going to give it to him. They were just mocking him. And so the crowd says, "Save yourself." And the Roman soldiers say, "Hey, save yourself." And then one of the thieves gets in on the same line of argument. It says, "There was written a notice above him, which reads, 'This is the king of the Jews.' And one of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him and said, 'Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and save us.'" What is very interesting about this phrase is that this is a man who is a sinner who asks Jesus to save him. You see that? Does he get saved? Is he born again? No, he doesn't. And I think in society sometimes we get so used to, well, we'll just say this or repeat this or do this and that, and now you're good, now you're golden. We've never seen a change in your life. We've never seen any growth in you, but I just want to cling to the fact that one day in VBS a long time ago, you said, this is a guy asking Jesus to save him, and Jesus' response to him is very, very plain. If you see it, it's nothing. He doesn't respond to him. Jesus turned a lot of people away. When they're training people for evangelism, when you go to college and train for pastoral ministries and stuff, they don't tell you, if somebody comes up to you, turn them away. They're like, no, here's how you do it. And if they say this, then you say this. If they say this, then you say this. Here's your answer to this. Here's the scripture. People over and over again in the New Testament coming up to Jesus. What do I have to do to have eternal life? He's like, for you, because you're God's stuff, you have to renounce that. You have to sell your stuff, give it to the poor, follow me. And the man went away bitterly. Somebody else, can I bury my dad first, Jesus? Jesus said, no, let the dead bury their dead. Which sounds callous on the surface, but they had to bury people within 24 hours. So if he was at Jesus' sermon, his dad's not dead. His dad was just getting up in years, and this guy was like, someday in the future when my dad's not here anymore and I've got his inheritance and a little more cushion and I've paid off some of my debts, can I come then? Jesus is like, no, you can't come then. You got to do it now, man. Now is the time. Today is the day of salvation. And over again, this guy's hanging on the cross, insulting him, and says, if you're really the Messiah, save yourself. And by the way, save us, because I would want that. Because this guy, just like the people who said, give us Barabbas, was thinking about being saved from his own situation and not saved from his sin. And the guy on the other cross looks at Jesus, and he knows exactly who this guy is. He can tell that he is a righteous man, and if nothing else, he is the Messiah. And so this man responds, and he says, don't you know who he is? Why are you doing this? He rebuked him. Don't you fear God? Since you are under the same sentence, we're punished justly, for we're getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong. Then he said to Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus answered him, truly I tell you, today you're going to be with me in paradise. Now, how many of you guys are skeptical? You have that same bent that I have. No skeptics in the whole room. Mere sheep. No, I'm just kidding. No, I'm joking. So anyway, I know some of you are, and you're just like, I don't participate except in worship, and I just really want you to know that. I'm sitting on my hands now, so this very thing does not happen. All right, so I don't know what you're going to ask me if I'm a skeptic. I wasn't going to ask you. I was just asking if you were a skeptic. Anyways, I get skeptical about stuff like this. This is one of the things that I read about when I was still an agnostic that I thought was a contradiction in Scripture. This is one of those things that I've had atheists talk to me about where they pointed this out, that Jesus said he was going to be with him today in paradise, and then Jesus later rises from the dead. He meets Mary Magdalene in the garden, and she tries to hug him. He's like, don't touch me. I have not yet ascended to my Father. Well, how did he not yet ascended to his Father when he was in paradise? And we come up with all these theological implications for paradise being another place or Abraham's bosom. We're not going to get into all that. Whether it's another place, a holding cell, whatever, boom, 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 boom. Did Jesus go? Jesus also went to spirit prison. did some stuff there in 1 Peter. He led captivity captive, that he descended before he ascended. I mean, all this cool stuff. There's a lot going on in 3 days. It's busy even after death between that and the resurrection. Did he go to heaven too? He said he didn't. Did he? Is it? You know, and so as I was studying this, even as not being a Christian, after I became a Christian and I'd given my life over to God because I'd seen lives changed and I'd given it on faith and just know I'm not going to be able to answer some of this stuff, I was looking into this as I had studied Greek, and it hit me one day. There's no punctuation in Greek. There's no commas. There's no parentheses. There's no quotation marks. There's no periods. It's all based on context. And when we started adding this to make it flow in English, a comma, the placement of the comma in this passage changes the entire meaning of the verse, but not the entire meaning. I'd say 95% of this verse has little to do with the timing of Jesus and the guy being together in paradise, and more to do with the promise that they would be together in paradise. That's the important part. That doesn't change. That little 5% depends on that comma. So when Jesus says, I tell you the truth, comma, today you'll be with me in paradise, that means it's going to happen today, sometimes in the next 24 hours. Move the comma over one word. I tell you the truth today, comma, you will be with me in paradise. Now it doesn't matter when we're going to be in paradise. It's just the fact that I said it, so it's going to happen. I'm telling you the truth today. All right? So completely, that blew my mind. So if you're a skeptic, that might help you out. But it's one of those things that I even, like, thought about, should I not even bring that up? It's kind of a rabbit trail. I was like, no, it's cool, and it blew my mind when I looked at that. So I'm going to bring it up and confuse somebody this morning, and that would be great. So he tells the guy they're going to be together. Now, this is where the weird stuff starts happening. You've got several groups of people who are here. You've got the women who are mourning, all the people who love Jesus, one of his disciples who showed up, his mother who showed up. You've got the Roman soldiers, and you've got all the Jews who were like, yeah, crucify him. You've got all these groups here, all watching the same thing. And all of a sudden, the lights are turned off. God turns off everything. It says it was now noon in the Middle East. I'm adding that, this parenthesis here. Noon in the Middle East, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. For the sun stopped shining, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. The curtain of the temple was 30 feet tall, very thick, multi-layered, and only one guy could go behind it once a year, and he had to go through all these purification things before he did, because it was symbolizing the wall, that impenetrable veil between us and God because of sin. And he would come through, and he would make atonement for the people, that God would have his presence with them for one more year and overlook that sin until the Messiah could pay for it. And God said, that part is done. It's done away with. It's fulfilled. Jesus is giving his life for you. And they have it all darkness. Think about this. These guys didn't even know the veil's being ripped. They're not going to find out until they go into the temple the next day. Like, oh. All these people who had thought this is what's happening and this is a good thing, Jesus needs to die, all of a sudden, dark, earthquakes, just some really, and Matthew tells us some of the graves were open and people came out and were seen by people, you know, like, okay, you know, I mean, there's some weird stuff. I mean, obviously something powerful is happening that could change people's minds about their decision to put Jesus on the cross. Then Jesus calls out in a loud voice, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. When he said this, he breathed his last. Now, when we think about Jesus dying for us, we think about all the love Jesus had for us, right? Wow, Jesus loved us. Jesus must really think a lot of me. Look how great I am. I mean, we don't try to say that, but we're thinking it. Jesus really loved me. As a matter of fact, I heard a guy preach a message one time, and he brought up Finding Nemo. And he showed some clips, and he used it to show this parallel of the lost son, that we're lost, kind of like the prodigal son, and God out there looking for us. But that's not exactly a perfect picture of what Jesus was doing when he came to get us. He said for a good person, somebody might die. But Jesus committed himself, God committed himself, his love for us in this, that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. So you remember the beginning of Finding Nemo? When the barracuda comes and it eats his wife's name, Coral, eats Marlin's wife, eats all the eggs but Nemo's egg. If this is a perfect picture of what Jesus did, The rest of the movie would be Marlin trying to find the barracuda so he could forgive him for what he did. That's what he came. The movie Taken. You know, we're as a guy, man, this daughter gets taken. It's a human trafficking. And Liam Neeson has a special set of skills that I don't have. I'm glad he does. Every time he hits one of those human traffickers in the face trying to get closer and closer to rescuing his daughter, I'm like, yeah, get him. Oh, yeah. You know, as a guy, I'm like, dude, yeah, this is awesome. I don't know how long I would have stayed in the theater had I found out there was nothing wrong with his daughter, nothing going on, but he got wind, even as a retired guy who used to have all these skills in the CIA, he got wind that a human trafficker had been taken hostage by another group of human traffickers, and that was just not right to him. And so he just set out the rest of the movie to free this guy, to give him a second chance at life. I'd be like, you are wasting your set of skills. There's so many people who are in slavery, who all this stuff has happened to. Why are you helping this guy? That movie would have bombed. Been the worst thing ever. Oh, yeah, here he goes. He's about to save this piece of human trash. Here we go. This is awesome. Yeah, get him. All right. Oh, they're embracing. That's wonderful. That's so nice. We would not watch that movie. We wouldn't have anything to do with it. But that is what Jesus did for us. While we were doing the things that made us enemies of the cross, Jesus came, and he wanted to free us from that. So after he says, into your hands I commit my spirit, how do the people react to this? Verse 47, the centurion, the guy in charge of the Romans who were at the cross, and seeing all this happen to make sure it all goes down. It says, seeing what had happened, he praised God and said, surely this was a righteous man. This wasn't his God that he was praising. He was praising the God of the Jews. He realized, uh-oh, we've made a mistake. Truly, he didn't recognize that he was the Son of God or anything, but he knew there was something about this person that made him unique and that he really was godly. When the people who had gathered to witness the sight and saw what took place, they beat their breasts and went away. They had been goaded into this by the priests, you know, where they're standing back there, crucify him, crucify him. He's a terrible guy. He hates people. You know, like all this stuff. And then they're like, yeah, crucify him. And they're screaming out. Now they saw this happen in utter silence for 3 hours because they can't walk home. They can't see to take another step. And they're standing there. And all this happens. And the light starts coming back on. And they heard Jesus break the silence by saying, in your hands I commit my spirit. And then the lights come back on. And Jesus is dead. And they're like, what have we done? God was priming the pump for Pentecost. These people went home beating their chests like, I cannot believe the guilt, the conviction that they had on them. When Peter stood up and said, you killed the Son of God and crucified him, but he's come back from the dead. When he said that on Pentecost, they didn't rush Peter and crucify him too. How dare he blame us? They knew they were to blame. The same group of people that swells into Jerusalem at Passover comes back for Pentecost. It was a bunch of the same people standing there who said, yeah, we need to follow this Jesus. It fulfilled prophecy that was in Zechariah 12:10. I will pour out on the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem a spirit of grace and supplication. They will look on me, the one they have pierced, and they will mourn for him as one mourns for a child and grieve bitterly for him as one grieves for a firstborn son. But all those, back in verse 49, all those who knew him, including the women who had followed him from Galilee, stood at a distance watching these things. Remember, they were the ones weeping and wailing. What are we going to do? They're killing Jesus. They're killing Jesus. The other people, crucify him. They're all loud and everything. And when it was all said and done, when they saw who he was and how Jesus responded to people on the cross and what God did with the atmosphere, it was opposite. They were standing there just taking it in. Like Mary did when she had Jesus and she pondered all these things in her heart. And the others were leaving with the weeping, not believing what they had done to the Son of God. He was set up to be a spectacle for us so that we wouldn't have to be. Would you bow your heads with me? Now, I don't know where you're at spiritually. I don't know if you've prayed a prayer at some point in your life and you did so because you wanted help with the circumstances that you happened to be in at the time. Maybe today God's speaking to you saying, you know what? You weren't really choosing Jesus. You were choosing some form of Barabbas. You wanted something I wasn't offering, but I came to free you from your sin. Or maybe you've never done that. You've never given your life to Jesus, never given him your sin and placed your life in his hands so that he can unwrap the potential that is in you. Imagine the robbery that we have when we take ourselves and we never allow the one who made the blueprints for our soul to unroll those and show us what we're here for, that we rob everyone of the ability to see that part of the image of God in creation. And maybe you've come in today and you said, you know, that's me. I've not given my life to Jesus. I just want to give you an opportunity this morning because of what Jesus did, not because of what I've said, to respond to the gospel, to respond to the God who died for you, gave his life for you, and then showed he had power over death by raising from the dead 3 days later. If you'd say, that's me this morning, Nate, I've not given my life to Christ. I need to accept that. I don't want to be made a spectacle. I don't want to stand before God and not have an answer for it. I want Jesus to come and stand beside me and say, this one is with me. If that's you, I just simply, just so I can tell where you're at, and to tell if God is speaking to anyone's heart in general, I want you to throw your hand up so I can see it. You'd say, I need to give my life to Jesus Christ this morning. Is there anyone who would say that? All right, let's pray. Father, I thank you for these your people. Lord, it's my prayer that everyone in here has made that decision, has given their life to Christ. And if that's so, God, you used 11 men and then added Paul to the numbers, to the ranks, to turn the world upside down for you, and there are far more than 12 in this room at this moment. I pray that Christ Community Church would turn Mooresville upside down for you. That we'd leave no stone unturned in our search for those who have yet to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. That we would see in our daily dealings, in our struggles, in our trials, in our tribulations, but you don't always come to save us from our circumstances. You came to save us from our sin. And God, even when we go through those circumstances, we would use it as an opportunity to glorify you and let people see our reaction and be led to the Father. Thank you so much for taking our place. Thank you for the spectacle you became so we don't have to be. In Jesus' name.